right, here we are, Winter NAMM 2018, and I'm here with the one and only Mr. Hartley Peavy. It's always great seeing you. How are you?
Great, Lewis. Great.
Awesome. Can you tell us what's new and exciting at Peavy this year?
Well, you know, Peavy is all about doing things a different way. Mm-hmm. This is why we've gained so many patents over the years. In fact, right now I believe over 180, which is probably more than all of our competitors put together in our end of the business. Uh-huh. And you get a patent for doing new and different things. And over the years, we've had a number of, technological milestones. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. You know, when transistors came in, and then when solid state came in, and then when digital things came in. And today, as far as sound systems, the thing that's very much in, as you can tell by a lot of our new products, is networking. Uh-huh. Networking and control and wireless, and we want to be at the front end of that. So the speakers behind me and a lot of the stuff you see in here are all controllable from iPads, all controllable control networking. And today, through the miracle of DSP, we can do things that 10 years ago would have been magic. That's true in guitar amps, it's true in sound reinforcement, and this whole connectivity thing. Uh-huh. Is one of those technological crossover points, if you will, and we're excited to be part of that.
It's you actually answered my second question, which I was going to ask you, being how, you know, there's a lot of challenges in the music industry.
Yeah.
There's a lot of companies selling a lot of the same product. I wanted to know, what is PB doing to stay ahead of that, and how do you overcome the challenges in the industry? But I think you just answered that.
Well, some of my competitors, you know, every year they have a new version of a 40 or 50 year old product, and that's their new thing. They also are big into reissues. PV doesn't do reissues because, frankly, when you do a reissue, what you're saying, without saying it in words, is you're telling your consumers that our old stuff is better than our new stuff. This is why PV doesn't do reissues. People say, well, why don't you bring back the Mace, or why don't you bring back this? And in that time, they were great products. But honestly, what we're doing today makes those products look like Stone Age.
I could answer the question on reissues, may I?
Yeah.
So I grew up, outside of my little 8-inch speaker combo amp, my first real amp was a PV Bandit 65. I was 15 years old, 15 or 16, maybe younger, 13 or 14. And now as an adult, it would be great to have the identical reissue. Well, it's more nostalgic, I think, than anything else.
Well, let me tell you a story about that.
Sure.
Back in my teenage years, I had a 57 Chevy. Mm-hmm. And my wife, my late wife, unfortunately, one Christmas, it was kind of bleak under the tree for me, which was not that unusual. And after it was all over, everybody had opened their little presents, and she says, well, look, come go with me out to the driveway. I said, why? She says, well, just shut up and come out here. Guess what was sitting in the driveway?
The car, the reissue, or the original?
A 1957 Chevy. Mm-hmm. The thing that was the pride of my life. I loved it. Mm-hmm. There it was, red and white, hard top. I jumped in it, turned the key, rode around the block, and dear God, it rode like a buckboard. No power brakes, no power steering. Mm-hmm. And the message is, sometimes our memory is not attuned to the facts. In that car, I had an AM radio, which I thought was great at the time.
Right.
Nobody listens to music on AM radio anymore. But, you know, we have made some great products in connection with some great artists. And what we're doing now is better than what we were doing then. But see, some of our friendly competitors, you know, this year they got a pink and blue version of a 50-year-old guitar, or a new signature model, or this is the professional model. I mean, we don't do that.
Right.
We make the best products.
You innovate.
Well, that's
I think
what
that's the key word.
You know,
for PV.
I think I've told you before. My goal when I started 65, almost 53 years ago, was to be the best. By definition, you can't be the best unless you're different.
Right.
If you look at PV, every time you come in our display at a trade show, we're showing you different stuff. Not the same old stuff. Not, oh, well, this is our new product. It's painted blue instead of green like last year. We don't do that. We push the state of technology. We're doing things that, frankly, we have the technology to do that many of our competitors do not have the technology to do.
Right, right.
For reasons that I've never been able to understand, a lot of people think that PV is just this little company. It never fails. It never fails. PV is a company that does things different. Mm-hmm. Why do we do it different? Not for the sake of being different, for the sake of being better. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and I've told you this before, mm-hmm. what keeps me interested is that every day I get to learn something.
Right.
And if you do that every day for 52 years, mm-hmm. almost 53, you figure out, well, you have learned a few things. But the other side of that coin is the more you know, mm-hmm. the more you realize that you don't know.
Right.
And the only way that you can know is to keep on pushing, keep on shoving. And that's why you see me, yep. instead of an office somewhere, I'm out here shucking and jiving,
right.
and talking to customers, talking to artists, because, you know, I want to build a better product. Mm-hmm. My product today is good, very good. We think better than the competition. My product next year and the year after will be better than what I'm doing today. And that's what it's all about.
You know what's interesting, and sometimes when you point out the obvious, you know, the light bulb goes on, right? So I want to point out a few obvious points. It's PV Electronics.
Right.
When you think about an electronics company, for an electronics company to stay abreast of the market, they have to innovate, right? And
well,
PV is more than just the name of the company. It's the electronics component is really the innovation behind everything you do. There's not a lot of companies that are electronics company.
Well, there's a lot of electronics companies. We also make, you know, guitars.
Yes, of course.
And I never set out to make guitars. Mm-hmm. The only reason I started making guitars is my competition were going in and putting pressure on dealers, mm-hmm. essentially saying, well, if you don't buy our sound systems or our amplifiers and have at least as many as you do PV, we're not going to sell you our famous name guitar.
Sure.
Which technically is illegal. It's called tying. But I hate legality, so I just decided that if they were going to use their guitars or basses mm-hmm. as leverage, that I'd do the same thing. And that's why we innovated a new way to make guitars and basses in 1977 with computer-aided machinery. And a lot of people are bragging today that they use computer-aided machinery and they use robots to buff guitar necks. Well, we were doing it in 1977.
Sure, sure.
So why did we do that? Because frankly, I had gone through the factories of mm-hmm. the major brands and I knew that wasn't the way to do it. Mm-hmm. So we started with a clean sheet, mm-hmm. a better mousetrap. That's what PV is all about.
Right.
And the direct beneficiary is the players of the world, the people that use sound systems, the people that play musical instruments. Mm-hmm. You know, the best today is not as good as the best a year from now,
right.
or 10 years from now. Mm-hmm. And that's why PV doesn't do reissues.
Right. You had mentioned, what was the thing that you mentioned was illegal that companies were doing?
Tying.
What is that?
Tying. If you are a music dealer mm-hmm. and some company comes in and says, well, look, we're not going to sell you our famous name guitars if you don't do this. So that's called tying.
Right.
You can't, in a free economy, you can't tie right. performance.
Sure.
And that's what they do. It's illegal. But I don't like legalities and those kinds of things. So I figured, you know, just to be crude, I was going to fight fire with fire. If they were going to use their famous name guitars against me, uh-huh. I'd just get in the guitar business. And we introduced an American-made guitar uh-huh. for $300.
Summer name, you just did the relaunch of a guitar line.
Yeah, that was a guitar that we did with a very famous artist
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
that, by the way, we designed.
Yes.
So we reintroduced it and took to a lot of success, I'm happy to say.
Good.
Because we did a lot of things like putting graphite pultrusions in the neck, mm-hmm. Which, you know, I guess other people have done it, but when you were using bird's eye maple, which is the worst possible material for a neck,
right.
because the grain goes every which way, the only way we could get the thing to be stable is to put two graphite pultrusions
right.
next to the truss rod. And we did a few very innovative things, but the fact is it was PV that did it. The guy that actually designed that guitar is no longer with PV, but it's Jim DeCola. Mm-hmm. Who's still a friend of mine.
Okay.
We communicate. And that Jimmy, he was the man.
Got it.
So I've always, anybody asks me, I always tell the truth. And the designer was not me.
Sure.
It was Jimmy DeCola.
So let me ask you something. You know, you mentioned about you had the guitar, you originally designed the guitar. There's not only a lot of copies out there, but there's a lot of counterfeit product out there.
It's a real problem. It's a real problem, especially in the third world countries.
Right. And that was my question. What do you, obviously, I know what you think about it, but
it's virtually impossible. Because it's like whack-a-mole. You hit this and it pops up over there.
Right.
And you gotta understand, China's a bigger country than the USA.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the Chinese copies, I hate to say it, are pretty good.
Right.
Pretty good.
What bothers me and should bother you is that really it's the musician that gets gypped because they might think they're getting the real thing and they're not.
That's right. It's like people file sharing.
Right.
I mean, it's once the genie is out of the bottle.
Right.
And you know, the reality is if you've got people that are good at copying, they get better and better at copying. And a lot of times it's difficult to tell the real thing.
Mm-hmm.
But the frustration for me, you know, musicians get frustrated because people downloading their music and file sharing and all that. But I don't know how to stop it.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? They don't know how to stop it either.
Sure.
So for all intent purposes, it's not stoppable.
Maybe just education, educating people,
the fact is most people, especially in third world countries, right, they don't know the fine points.
Right.
You see, we worry about liability, product liability.
Sure.
We worry about performance,
mm-hmm,
serviceability. But when they copy, I mean, we may use a 2-watt resistor where we didn't need to, but we just use it because it needs to be there.
Right.
But they'll stick a 1/2-watt resistor in where a 2-watt resistor, and it'll work for a while.
Mm-hmm.
But then if it fails, they don't blame the copycat, they blame me.
Sure.
I had nothing to do with it.
Right.
So that is a very frustrating.
And it's out there in the open. I think there were a couple of incidents where Amazon.com were, not intentionally, but companies brought to their attention that they were selling counterfeit product, and it's hurting businesses, it's hurting consumers.
It's counterfeit product, but you know, look, people are people.
Right.
Everybody's looking for a deal.
Right.
But when a deal is too good,
if it's too good to be
it
true,
it probably
right.
is too good to be true.
There you go.
But it's one of those things, and the way we fight it, rather than going out and trying to find somebody in Podong Lane somewhere, we just change our products as often as we can. We push technology.
And that's a good point. And you kind of addressed that also. When you're innovating and you're constantly a step ahead, it's hard to copy when you're always a step ahead.
That's
right. It's actually a really good point.
That's right. But when you're making the same old,
it's easy to copy.
It's easy to copy.
There's your answer right there.
So, but folks, we're trying to build a better mousetrap, and that's the way it's been from the first.
Mm-hmm.
As long as I have anything to do with it, that's the way it's going to be.
Sure.
Okay.
So last question for you. You've been coming to NAMM since the 50s?
My dad was a music dealer,
mm-hmm,
and my first NAMM show was in 1954,
mm-hmm,
in Chicago. I think it was at the Palmer House.
Okay.
And I'd never been to the big city before, and we were on the 19th floor,
wow,
and I thought it was just amazing.
Nice.
Except for when I was in college, and except for when I was in the military, I've been to most of them,
mm-hmm,
ever since.
So, what do you like most about the NAMM show? If you could think about the stuff you would do more of, the stuff you do less of, where's your mind
at
with NAMM?
I get to see a lot of old friends. Like I ran in to Seymour Duncan last night,
mm-hmm,
and I've known Seymour forever, and have great respect for what he's been able to,
mm-hmm,
do. And a lot of old friends, but you know, us old guys, you get tired. That's the only thing about being older. But you know, the good thing is I'm still upright, I'm still here.
Good.
And just listen, to survive in this crazy business for nearly 53 years is a pretty good trick.
Right.
I mean, you look out there, you know, most of the companies, the innovators, they sell out or something happens to them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Leo started his in 46 and sold it to CBS in 65. That was 19 mm-hmm. years. I've been at it for almost 53.
And you are the passion behind the name, which is,
well, you know,
there's a lot to be said for that.
Well, I don't know whether you can sense the passion, but we're all like that.
Right.
In fact, it's
But compared to other companies, I think some companies are more just business, the bottom line. I think passion exists here.
Well, you know, music, we've talked about it before. Music is about passion. Music is one of the few things that people actually will fight you over.
Right.
There's religion and politics and romance and music. Right. If you happen to like a particular kind of music and somebody is sitting next to you having a drink and said, well, anybody that likes so-and-so has got to be an idiot, you want to say, what? You know, but that's the passion of it.
Right.
You know, it's a funny thing when somebody is a guitar player, and at one time I thought I was a guitar player until I heard some really good ones. Somewhere down in my psyche, I still consider, and I haven't actively played guitar, because I found out the hard way that wasn't my talent.
Right.
My talent was using these, building things. I believe that all of us are given talents.
Right.
You can call them abilities. It doesn't matter what you call them. All of us are given that, and the trick in life is to figure out what you're talented at, and then have the intestinal fortitude to do that.
Mm-hmm.
What if I had continued to try to be a musician? Where would I be today? I'll tell you where. Broke, destitute, and unhappy.
Right.
I realized that that was not the gift that I was given. My dad was a great musician. I didn't get that. But to hang a picture on the wall was a test of his mechanical ability. But me, I used to win science fairs, and all the teachers thought that I should be a genius. But you can look at my grades and see that was not true. The truth is, I was good with my hands. I built model airplanes and won model airplane contests. And looking back over that, it should have been obvious to me, but it wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to be a musician.
Sure.
But my talent was building things.
Did you ever hear the joke, what's the difference between a musician and a pizza?
No.
A pizza will feed a family.
Well, the music business has been good to me. I've created opportunities. In our 52 and a half year history, we've employed a little under 15,000 people. Almost 15,000 people have come through PV. And in our little part of the world, there's probably not a family that hasn't had a son, daughter, uncle, aunt, cousin, nephew, you know, working at some division of PV. And, you know, as human beings, the best we can ever hope to do is to make a difference.
Yes.
Hopefully for the better.
Mm-hmm.
And if I keeled over today, then I like to think that I have made a difference.
You have.
Happiness to me is never having to say I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Have I made mistakes? Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Have I screwed over people? Absolutely not.
Mm-hmm.
I can walk out this show and there's not one person that can realistically say, accurately say, hey, you screwed over me.
Right.
Not true. Not true. And I feel good about that.
Good. And I think you should, because those are important fundamentals we should all live by.
Well, at PV, I do not allow anybody to call me Mr. PV. True.
But meanwhile, I still do.
Well, you're not at PV, but you could be if you wanted to be.
Maybe someday.
It's been an interesting journey.
Great.
Which thankfully is still going on.
There it is. You got to hear it from Mr. Bartley PV, Winter NAMM 2018.
Thank you, Lewis,
so much for making the time.
We appreciate what
you
did.
And I missed you last year, so I'm glad we were able to
I had the flu last year.
I know. We missed the yearly interview. I'm glad we got it
all right
for this Winter NAMM.
Okay.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Okay.